Great. So I'm going to ask you, first of all, how many of you have a Twitter account? So you can feel free to Twitter along with me. I never really like to see my Twitter reviews because people always feel obliged to pick up on that single statistic you don't get right or that word you mispronounce. But we're all living in the age of a social world that heretofore we could have never imagined. I sat behind the curtain and listened to the origins of your organization, founded in the same year that I graduated from Brown University, at a time when, to do my honors thesis in sociology, we needed a card reader. And I was sitting back there working on two Blackberries, managing an office, one in London, one in New York, also managing my Facebook account, trying to figure out who was doing what in my home and thinking, you know what, maybe the old days were really a lot better because there's something completely broken about the fact that I no longer read a print newspaper because I'm reading about 1,000 newspapers a day using a series of Google alerts that are self-creating a newspaper for me based on about 400 topics I'm interested in. And that really is the social mind that we are living in. We're living in an age, too, of trilogues. It used to be dialogues. I could come and talk with one of you, and it would be a conversation. It could be a great conversation. I could speak to a colleague. I could speak to a friend. Today, that conversation's great, but that's controlled, and we don't really live in an age of any kind of control anymore. The world's totally out of control. What really matters is not what a newspaper reporter says or what a published report, a restaurant review says. What actually matters is the third, the fourth, the fifth, the 18th report, that trilogue, that pass along, that extra person who chimes in, that unsolicited comment, that employee who loves you, who hates you, that person who's having a bad moment. I don't know how many of you are managing brand reputations, your own reputation, through a series of alerts, through any of these free aggregators, and are watching this where you begin to realize you can only manage so much, and the rest is totally out of control. I also want to flag for you something else about social media, and that is the degree to which what started off really as the domain of scientists in the military, the internet, has, like, just like the history of the telephone, become the domain of women. The history of the phone is really quite interesting. I can even, in the back of my mind, remember when the telephone was at a phone table in my grandmother's home, and it really sat by the front door, and when it rang, it was considered an invasion of our family's privacy. And like most families, I suppose, in our family, in the 60s, it moved to the kitchen, and very soon thereafter, it moved to the bedroom, my parents' bedroom, but it was only for emergencies. And you really managed the usage of the phone with some recognition of both cost and just the inappropriateness of using it for personal conversations. But actually what happened with the phone was men went back to work and women discovered while it was sitting in their kitchen, if they picked it up and they used it, they could speak to their mothers, their sisters, others, and it became an instrument of social life. And within a couple of years, it became an extension of the family. It became a tool of intimacy. And the same exact thing happened with the internet. And social media became even more of that. We have to actually start off and remember what social media really was. In the very beginning, it was nothing more than Facebook. And Facebook was nothing more than the Ivy League pig book system. Any of you in the room that attended an Ivy League school in the 70s or the 80s remember very, very well the pig book. It was the Facebook that was handed out freshman year. It was a very bad passport photo of yourself with your dorm room and the assigned switchboard phone number. And men and women used it to sort of plot out who they wanted to meet early that year. Upper class people used it to scope out people they'd like to run into. And Facebook was an electronic version of it. In the cash settlement between the two groups, Uconnect and Facebook, and it was a $65 million settlement, they acknowledged that it was really an Ivy League dating service. And I, for one, was brought the concept probably 5 years ago, and I said, this is absolutely ridiculous. There's absolutely no business idea here. It's nothing but an Ivy League hookup service. And look at us today, how we're all using Facebook to manage every relationship we have, to not only post on there, but to trialogue with everyone. Because think about it, you not only post your mood, you share an 140-character status update, everything that's going on in your life, but then you actually vote on how you feel about what other people have said about how you've just said you feel. And we're all thinking about everything in 140-character update.